my learned and distinguished colleague, Justice Sharad Bobde, Chief Justice Manjula Chellur, learned Attorney General of India, Sri Mukul Rohatgi, my four most distinguished former Chief Justices, Chief Justice B.P. Singh, Chief Justice C.K. Thakkar, Chief Justice Anil Dave, and Chief Justice Mohit Shah, former judges of the Supreme Court, before whom I've had a great opportunity to appear as a young junior, present and former Chief Justices of the High Court, judges of the Bombay High Court, distinguished members of the bar, and last but not the least, the authors of today's event, my good friend, President Milind Sathe, Birendra Saraf, and the members of the Executive Committee, distinguished members of the bar. When a member of the bar travels from the bar to the bench, there are two psychological barriers which she or he has to confront. The first is that you have to face your own colleagues from the bar, now as a judge sitting on the other side, many of whom you shared a cup of tea just the previous evening with in the Bombay Bar Association on the AAWI bar room. And it's a big psychological change, but we are all taught by the professionalism of our institution that you can be friends at the bar, but yet you can dispense justice objectively. But that reminds me of a story when C.K. Daftari was arguing a case before the Bombay High Court, and since the book was not available with the judges, Daftari handed over the law report to the judge, and there was a little bug which had crept up in the book. So the judge mentioned to Daftari, he said, "Mr. Daftari, there is a little bug which is in this copy which you have given to me." So Daftari, in his inimitable style, said, "Yes, my lord, there is a tendency of some bugs to travel from the bar to the bench." I always have this feeling that somebody of that kind must be saying this to me as well. But there is an even more great a psychological barrier which a judge from the bar has to face. And that's the barrier, the psychological barrier, when you address your own, when you address not merely friends at the bar, but you address seniors at the bar from whom you have learned the infant steps as a member of the bar. But this is today an occasion not just to pay homage to those greats in whose path we have now assumed the mantle of this institution, but the greats with whom we are fortunate to be here today, from whom we have learned so much that we have learned from the profession. And I am deeply conscious of the fact that though I've been requested to speak as a judge of the Supreme Court, as a member of the Bombay Bar Association, I'm deeply aware of the fact that the stream can never rise above the source. What we've heard this morning shows you the excellence of our bar. It's virtually an assembly line of brilliance. Attorneys General, law officers, cabinet ministers, members of parliament, judges, diplomats, leaders of industry, thinkers, intellectuals, writers, people who joined in the fight for freedom, freedom against colonial rule, as well as freedom truly after independence as well. They've all belonged to our bar. But equally, let us not forget today others who never achieved the fame, nor did they win the accolades which a few win from the bar and the bench in society. For those who don't get the fame and the titles, they give the bar its color, its texture, as well as its personality. They make the bar a way of life and not just a profession. So we have in our bar the cynical as well as the optimists. We have in our bar the believers and the non-believers. We have the conservatives and we have the liberals. We have the straight and the not so straight. Not merely in terms of integrity, but in terms of sexual orientation as well. We have those who have tread the beaten path, and we have the mavericks. We have armchair stockbrokers, musicians, actors, golfers, and cricketers. But by and large, lawyers from our bar, I believe, fall into three categories. You have those who do nothing but the law. That's the first category. Then you have the second of those who do something apart from the law. And then there is a third and very important category of those who do everything but the law. But I think the hallmark of our bar is that we welcome and accept others, because that's the hallmark of this great metropolitan city that Mumbai is. We accept not merely people who are not from Mumbai, who have made a life and livelihood in Mumbai, but we accept others who don't think like us. We accept people who don't speak like us. We accept people who don't believe or worship as we do. There is in the Bombay bar, and I think that's a great hallmark of our bar and the strength of the bar, there is a tolerance of diversity. There is an acceptance of the pluralism of India. And we are fiercely committed to the cause of freedom. Why is it that our bar has achieved such high levels of excellence? And thinking about it and reflecting on it, I think I can identify two features. The first, I think, is the training which every junior member of the bar receives to achieve professional excellence. And the second is the maintenance of the highest standards of personal integrity. As a young junior, when I came from Delhi to Mumbai, one of the first things that I learned was how serious the business of settling a pleading is taken in Mumbai. I drafted a plaint in the manner of a writ petition, replete with grounds and case law. And the senior who drafted it, my own senior, Mr. Andhyarajna, who helped settle the pleading, looked at each one of the underlying documents, then looked up the draft, and I stood over on the table watching my draft being mercilessly torn apart. But that's the seriousness with which pleadings are settled in Mumbai. On a lighter vein, without meaning any disrespect, many years later, I handed over a set of written submissions to a very distinguished former Attorney General of India who was leading me in a challenge to the Bharat Petroleum Acquisition of Undertakings Act. And he said, "You collect it after 10 days. Mr. Rohatgi, absolutely no offense intended. Very distinguished Attorney General of India told me, he says, "You collect it after 10 days, it's deemed to be settled." But then he said, "Well, I trust you to have drafted a good pleading because you belong to Mumbai." But we also learned from the seniors the art of cross-examination. A senior who is present here, who I'll not name, I was pestering him to ask a question in the course of an evidence trial, an evidence action. And he asked me, "Do you know the answer to that question?" And I fumbled. And I said, I'm sorry, I'm not quite sure what the answer would be. And the senior said, "Never ask a witness a question to which you don't know what the answer is going to be." Or something as simple as drafting minutes of the order. But we have all, in our own way, been beneficiaries of random acts of kindness, because I think it's these random acts of kindness which sustain the bar. And I'll only mention at a very personal level four random acts of kindness, if only to tell a story to the younger members of the bar. And I'll tell a few stories of four members who are not with us. But I've benefited from these random acts of kindness from across the bar. But I'll not embarrass those who are present here. I'll only mention four who are not with us today. I was briefed with Firdaus Talyar Khan, the great and redoubtable Firdaus. We finished the matter, and Firdaus said, how much are you planning to mark for this matter? So I again mumbled and fumbled. I said, Firdaus, I was not sure what to mark. So Firdaus looked at me and said, I would have marked 150 guineas. As the Attorney General knows, 15 guineas, one guinea is 15 rupees in Mumbai, 14 in Calcutta. So he said, I would have marked 150. You would have been able to mark 50, which is one third of what the senior is marking. I'll increase my fee to 220 so that you can mark 70. I believe the seniors of today would add three zeros to that figure. When I came from Delhi to Mumbai to set up practice with a young child in tow, we had no place to stay. When my dear friend Sangeeta Manohar told me that, well, there's a lady here, very senior solicitor by the name of Sohini Ben Nanavati, who has a small flat and she just gives it out to juniors who are in need of accommodation. So I went very nervous to Sohini Ben and I asked her, well, I said, I don't have a place to stay. And she didn't ask me who I was. She said, just walk into my place tomorrow. After staying in that flat for a year, when it was time to leave, I walked across to her and I said, Sohini Ben, can I please offer something? And she said, thank you for your impudence, but no. Then we had somebody like Barrister Raja Bhosle, who once gave me a murder appeal to argue where 13 accused had been convicted under Section 302. And I called up Barrister Bhosle and said, Raja Bhosle, am I going to argue this murder appeal? He says, well, if I can trust you to argue an appeal involving three convicts under 302, what's your problem? We had Milind Sakhadande, whose fear of flying to New Delhi meant that he wouldn't travel and argue his SLPs, but we were the beneficiaries because he would give us his briefs, dig into his pockets, which were rather deep, pull out a wad of currency notes and tell us, go and argue this in the Supreme Court tomorrow. And of course, there was this great and beneficent tradition of a senior who would give you that ever sought after monogrammed bag for having argued a case well or assisted your senior well. So we have before us a tradition of the brilliance of the bar and its judges. We can never forget the oratory of Anani Palkhiwala or the erudition of Homi Sirvai. As India enters a globalized world, let us not forget that the strong foundations of commercial law has originated in the work of lawyers and judges drawn from the Bombay Bar. The Lord Chief Justice of England, Lord Thomas, in January this year, lamented about the fact that this great move towards ADR in London was diluting the importance of the commercial bar and the ability of the High Court to lay down law. Let that not happen to the Bombay High Court, because we need to fortify and build upon the principles of commercial law. Globalized India is not a matter of mantra, but how well we write our judgments. And how well we write our judgments in the High Court depends on how well our lawyers argue the cases. Because a judgment is as good as the lawyers who presented the arguments before the court. What then are the challenges of the day? And I dare say, as someone belonging to you, I can raise these issues without a fear of being misunderstood. The first challenge which we need to confront is a sense of isolation which professional excellence brings. And I dare say this is a real problem which I perceive from the Bombay Bar. Your sense of professional excellence makes you so focused in your work that you tend to get isolated from the realities of life. The second is the indifference towards society which material wealth brings. And this is one of the great dangers of success in the profession. A success which breeds a degree of indifference to what is happening around you in society. The third is the cynicism towards governance and the holding of a public office. And that's not merely in the fact that more and more lawyers are saying no when called upon to assume the august office of a judge of the High Court. I don't blame them necessarily. Times have changed. The institution has changed. Our own institution has come under very grave scrutiny. So the fault doesn't lie only on the part of the lawyers who say no. But why this sense of cynicism about public office and governance? Chief Justice Chagla was known as much for his distinguished work on the bench as he was known for rallying together the forces of freedom during the emergency. I'm not sure which part of his life you can say was more important, but is that not a lesson to learn for us, that there is something in the life of the law which travels beyond what you do on the bar and on the bench? The fourth important challenge which I want to emphasize is the demand for integration. There is life beyond intellectual property, winding up, and motions. And I think one of the great and very desirable features of the bar in Mumbai today is the increasing integration, if not the complete integration, of the membership of the Advocates Association of Western India with the Mumbai Bar, with the Bombay Bar Association. We are all friends together, we work together, and we stand for the same causes. And I dare say that my life as a lawyer would not have been complete had I not learned from my good friends on the appellate sides the importance of a Saat Bara, something as simple as that, or the manner in which you read revenue records and to the extent to which you can use them on issues of title. And finally, one of the grave challenges which we have to face today is to reform our own outmoded ways of working. And by that I mean something more substantive than merely filling up our dockets, the green dockets, with our fees. I think we need to reflect, and this reflection is not going to come either by a parliamentary legislation or by the Commercial Courts Bill, but by our own effort to reform, by our own effort to look around and see what's happening in the world outside, in trying to improve our own efficiency, in adopting technology, in harnessing the efforts of our judges to be more productive in the work which we do. We need to challenge and stretch our own capacities. What are the lessons then that we learn as members of this great association? We have learned that the bar is the bulwark of individual liberty. We have learned that individual freedom and the rule of law can thrive only with an independent judiciary. But we have also learned that maintaining judicial independence is not just a skate, but it's a long trek on thin ice. It's important for us to continue the oral tradition of our bar by telling stories, by telling the younger members of the bar of what we have imbibed, if only to remind us of the role of the bar, such as the events of 1988, when everyone stood unified in saying that we will not appear before judges whom we believe don't follow a path of rectitude. We have to also be conscious of the fact that some of our most distinguished judges, and I say with a great deal of emphasis, me excluded, some of our most distinguished judges from the Bombay High Court have gone to the Supreme Court. But it's also a matter of grave, grave reflection that some of our most distinguished never went to the Supreme Court. Which is not to say that a human being becomes great or loses his sense of greatness or her sense of greatness by a title or an office. But it's something to talk about the system. And if we need to encourage the young, if we need to encourage true talent from the bar into the bench, we need to create conditions where we provide conditions of certainty for professional advancement. And I think these are issues which are of grave concern to the members of the bar. And finally, I think it's important for us to learn that lawyers and judges are important, but we are not the only necessities of a free society. There are far other important elements involved in a free society, such as civil society, which has to be vibrant and active. And the reason why I mention that, both for the judges and the lawyers, is that when you realize that there is a large society outside, you learn to take your work seriously, but sometimes you learn not to take yourself seriously. There is a perception that the bar is closed. When I went to Allahabad, I saw over the period of 3 years how strong that perception is. We need to open up our portals to the young lawyers. There is a great amount of talent around, talent which has no access, talent which has no access to the centers of excellence in today's bar. How do we reach out to a talented young lawyer in Solapur? How do we reach out to a talented young lawyer in Ratnagiri? How do we reach out to a young lawyer, talented young lawyer in Firozabad, who wants to join the bar? I had one such lawyer who wrote a very strong email to me when I was Chief Justice of the Allahabad High Court, saying, "I've been trying my best to get an internship from one of your 90 colleagues, but nobody is willing to accept me." I thought that was indeed a very sobering reflection on the status of our bar. We need to open up our bar to true meritocracy. Finally, let us remind ourselves of how fortunate we are in Maharashtra. There are threats to judicial independence, but let's not be only led away by what the newspapers tell us. There are small threats to independence across the country which are never spoken of by the newspapers. As Chief Justice of the Allahabad High Court, I had to confront situations where judges are assaulted by members of the bar in a small district in Eastern UP. Judges who are abused by members of the bar because the bar has been overridden by people who do not necessarily belong truly to the legal profession. These are the genuine threats to judicial independence. I'll share a small story with you and then I'll be done. When I went to Allahabad, I found that every Friday, a whole lot of lawyers would take whatever train was available and go into the districts, sometimes ticketless, mostly sitting on the floor of the railway compartment. The lawyers would go to the district, collect work. The client would be in touch with the local lawyer. This young lawyer would be meeting a district court lawyer who would say that if you want this brief, this is all that I give you, file a matter in court. Where does he have the ability to say no? The cream would be taken by the local lawyer. The Allahabad lawyer got a pittance. There was a problem of whether many of the petitions were fake. How do we even know? Because petitions were never sworn before the High Court. So when we spoke to the members of the bar, I thought that we can find a solution by telling the lawyers that the identification of every petition which is filed in the High Court must take place in Allahabad so that the client has to come to Allahabad and be identified. There was a grave opposition on the ground that how can you impose this cost on the client? But I thought that the greater need for the institution was that we must do this for the bar and to ensure against frauds in the filing of petitions before our court. So I promised the bar that we will give you 100 rupees per affidavit or per petition. We realized at the end of 1 year that the bar collected 1.5 crore, but we did it with a condition that their accounts would be audited, that there will be a provision for funding young juniors from across the state of Uttar Pradesh who don't have the wherewithal to live through the first few years of the profession. A welfare scheme such as a group life insurance scheme, a health insurance scheme for lawyers. And that is what has really come about. So we are involved really in this common effort on the part of the bench and the bar. I thought I'd begin by telling you about the Bombay Bar, which you know much more than I do. But I thought I must also share with you some of the experiences, because there is, after all, an India beyond Maharashtra. And And there is life beyond the Bombay bar. And I think we need to understand our position as members of the bar in the wider scheme of things, in the wider context of Indian society. And the last 1 minute now, I'll tell you a story about how the Bombay original side was saved. Justice Kapadia and Justice Kudukar upheld the Transfer of Jurisdiction Act, the Abolition of Jurisdiction Act in 1988. I was briefed with my senior before the Supreme Court in an appeal against a judgment, a split judgment of Justice Bharucha and Justice Sugla over the penalization of some members, young students from the class 10 or class 12 board examination. And we were arguing before a bench of Justice Sawant. Suddenly, some group of young lawyers came running and said, "Sir, the original side matter has been called out before Justice Kuldeep Singh. And Justice Kuldeep Singh is not willing to keep the matter back and says, I'm going to dismiss this. You argue it today or I'm going to dismiss it." So my senior tried the first strategy in the books of every lawyer, said, "I'd like to cite a few very important authorities if I get a few days' time to place these before you." So Justice Kuldeep Singh said, "Sir, I'm AR 1992 Supreme Court. What are you going to cite before me?" But somehow, the day passed by, the matter was not dismissed, and the rest is history. We are still afloat. Thank you very much.